they're standing up there, but that's okay.
Thank you. You know, there's a song, I can't remember the name of the song, that calls us to stand up, and you'll fall for anything if you don't take a stand. And we need to take a stand for our faith today. So we're going to be talking about witnessing today. So please, as you go through and we sing our songs and we pray our prayers, keep that one word in your mind, a word in your mind too. We're going to start our service this morning with the hymn of praise, Crown Him with Many Crowns. You all can say.
Jesus, the name above all names. exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted. Exalted on high, I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign.
No one else will do.
join me this morning in a time of personal and silent prayer, our morning prayer, and in closing our Lord's Prayer. Lord God, we need you more than anything. In a world that just seems to have gone crazy, in a world where it's all right for violence to occur, it's all right for people to abuse other people, where it's all right not to go to church anymore, Lord God, it seems so sad sometimes that it's come to this. But Lord, when we're through with all our whining and through with all our negativity, we know you are there waiting. That you are always there. You are there by our sides. You are there when we groan and moan and complain about things. Lord, help us to be a witness to you. Help us be a witness to your word, a word that is so needed. And Lord, it's hard to be a witness in this world. Sometimes people who attempt to do that are met with derision, are met with words of, they just aren't good to hear, Lord. Help us to change that, Lord. Give us the strength to stand up to the situations and the people that we need to stand up to. Be the only presence in our lives that lead us and guide us and tell us what you would have of us. And Lord, help us to pray that prayer that you have taught us from the beginning.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, says, the main part they wanted me to read is he told them that this is written, that Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins.
sin will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Now, I could ask if you know what a witness is. I don't know if you've probably ever seen it. I can bet these folks out here have. I have a gentleman here that happens to have been a lawyer that he knows what witnesses. Yes, he's been in many courtrooms. But, so every time I started doing this, I thought, well, will that bring that gentleman in right to this? Because he talks to us a lot about this on what he's doing. What do I say? Anyway, men's group, when we have it, he is getting into this and really getting into more than I ever knew about, which is great, because you always learn something new about Jesus and how the Bible is written on things. But anyway, a witness is a person that may be testifying in court. If you've ever seen shows on TV where they're doing that, okay? It might be a person who was seen in that accident, witnessed a crime, or being asked to testify about the character of someone they know. Even Pastor Doug threw one at me this morning and says, when you go to buy tennis shoes, wow, you're witnessing that I want them tennis shoes because everybody has them. And I said, well, that is a good one to throw at it. So here he threw one into mine already. Okay? Even if you have never been a witness, okay? And you've probably seen movies and TV shows such as a person that's called to a witness stand. And this is a good one here, okay? My Bible has been around for years, okay? Traveled around the world with me, trust me. Anyway, if you took your left hand and put on this Bible, can you put your hand on it for me? There you go. And then, and this is what they do, okay? And then if you raise your right hand and you say, you swear to tell the truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God. That's what they do in court for witness, okay? And then you tell them what you're supposed to do. That means not telling them a lie, but just telling them what you're doing as far as a witness, okay? And then after that, a witness is asked a question of knowing whether the case would help the jury or not make a decision. But if you've ever had to testify in court, it's nothing to worry about, okay, or being concerned about. All you have to do is tell the truth of what you've seen and what you know to be the truth. I'll get the right sheet here, okay? But as far as the Bible lesson goes, Jesus was talking to his disciples after he had been raised from the dead. The disciples didn't quite understand the resurrection. And even though they could see him and were talking to him, they thought they might be talking to a ghost. They were just a little bit frightened. And he said, why are you afraid? Why do you have doubts in your mind? Jesus asked it. Look at my hands and my feet. Touch me. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones as I do. Then he asked him, do you have anything to eat? Well, they gave him a piece of fish, and he took it and ate it to prove that he was not a ghost. After all, a ghost doesn't eat food, does he? Jesus helped the disciples understand the scriptures. He explained to them, the scriptures say that the Messiah must suffer, then 3 days later he will rise from the dead. They also said that people of every nation must be told in my name to turn to God in order to be forgiven of their sin. You're the first to hear and see it, as he told his disciples. You're the witnesses. You must tell everything that has happened. Jesus has called you and me to be witnesses also, because we read the Bible, and for us to tell other people about it is the witnesses to God. There is no reason for us to be afraid to testify. All Jesus wants us to do is tell others what he has done for us. He wants us to tell others how he has changed our life and about how he died and was raised from the dead eternal life. Help us to be a faithful witness about what he has done for us. In Jesus' holy name, we pray.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I decided to So I brought this wheelchair here that I just got. Well, we just got for Irma, and I may use it sometime too. But this wheelchair illustrates a Bible verse from Proverbs 19, verses 17. And that Bible verse says, "He that gives to the poor lends to the Lord, and the Lord will repay." I've probably read that in passing several times, but didn't really know what it meant. So you're going to know what it means. I'll say it again. He that gives to the poor lends to the Lord. I don't know if you know, but I am a Swede. And about every 2 years, Lindsberg celebrates as a Swedish festival, and I very seldom miss it. And Irma is Pennsylvania Dutch, but when Svenskilden's Fest comes around, she's as much a Swede as anybody. And she never misses it with me. Well, it's getting harder and harder for Irma to get around. And so I have a walker that I got from the VA with a seat on it. So I would push Irma around. But the problem with that walker is that she has to ride backwards. And her feet drag on the ground unless she has to hold them up. And that can get tiresome. Well, my son-in-law, Greg Holzmeister, decided that I was getting worn out pushing her around, and he said, "I'll take care of her from now on." And so he pushed her from store to store and here to there. And when we got done, Greg came to me and he says, "Wayne, you gotta get her in a wheelchair." And he said it in a way that he didn't give me any options. Well, I thought, you know, well, I can probably modify that walker so that she doesn't have to drag her feet. And Irma says, "You know, if you do that, Greg is going to be mad at you." And I sure don't want him mad at me, because he is a Subaru mechanic here, and he takes care of my car. So I started thinking seriously about a wheelchair. And when Greg was telling me, he says, "You need to check with the Salvation Army. They probably have used wheelchairs." Well, Friday, a week ago, my sister called and told me that her husband had died. And we needed to go to the funeral. And at that funeral, we were going to move from here to there. And I knew that we wanted to go to the cemetery. And Irma doesn't walk well in the cemetery, so we needed that. We needed a wheelchair. So I called the Salvation Army, and they didn't have any. Then I called Goodwill Industries, and they said, "Well, we don't normally sell wheelchairs because there's some liability connected with it. But we do have a wheelchair in the back. If you want to come and take a look at it, we'll probably sell it to you." So I said, "Okay." I was going to take Irma down to get a haircut, and then I was going to go check with Goodwill. Well, she wasn't thrilled about that. She was afraid I'd bring home something junky. And She went with me and waited in the car while I went in there and checked. And so I checked, and the lady said, ask for Sarah or Kevin. So I did. And so pretty soon they came with this wheelchair out. Well, a wheelchair like this costs retail about $275. I found out later, because I was curious what it would cost. And I said, okay, how much, that looks like it ought to work. How much do you want for it? And the lady said, $995. I said, $995? $9.95 didn't sound right. $9.95 didn't sound right. Because this was too nice of a wheelchair. But that's what it was. $9.95. I said, okay, I will take it. But Irma wants to approve it first. We've got to take it out to the parking lot and show it to her. So the lady clerk and the man clerk and I wheeled it out, and Irma looked at it, and of course she was thrilled about it. And we visited a little bit and decided that we would take it. She decided we would take it. And so they said, okay, we'll load it up for you. So they loaded it in the car. And I said, okay, let's go in the store and get you some money. And the lady said, oh, you don't have to pay anything for it. You can just pay it forward. All this thing cost us was the gas to drive down the Goodwill. And so that blew my mind away. I couldn't imagine why it had to be the Lord's doing. And so I remember this Bible verse, he that gives to the poor lends to the Lord, and the Lord will repay. I think that's something that I never imagined. Irma and I have always, ever since we got married, we did our best to tithe. We don't give all of it, that tithe, to the church, but we will give to the poor as we see a need. And we have done that. And the Lord has repaid us and has been a way of a blessing.
Amen.
What a witness. That is the witness I don't know.
Amen.
Pastor, may I say a couple of words?
You sure can, Chuck.
A way in the future, the VFW will help you in any way possible. Any military, we have carts. We have canes, we have crutches, and we would have been more than happy to put you in a wheelchair.
Now what's up?
Well, if you fly it for some reason, you need two, you come on down, we'll give you another.
Chuck, thank you very much.
With you, I'll wait a few years.
Now, I know we're taking time this morning, but this is time of God.
Yeah.
And so I want to bring one more witness forward this morning. And I've been waiting for this witness for a while. Marcus, can you please come up? You can use the microphone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, first of all, Chuck, I'm not ready for a wheelchair. So I just want to clear that up.
I'm not getting in a car, I'll
tell you. Just so you know. Well, I'm going to testify this witness because you probably heard Pastor Dunner talk about several times. He's saying that a person that walked by this church several times and finally just came in and decided to be a member of the church. Well, that would be I. My grandson. years old, we used to walk through here to go to the park. And every time he come this way, he said, "What is that?" And I said, "That's a church." He said, "Oh." Second time he come through, he said, "What's that?" I said, "I told you that was a church." Third time he came through, he said, "I'm going up in here. I'm going to go in this." I said, "It's closed." So I said, "Tell you what, let me look and see what time it is, and we're going to go the next time." So Bubby, my grandson, I told him, I said, "Well, it's at 10:15. Talk to your mom, and we're going to go to the church next time." So he was all excited. Well, we came in, and we never left. Love you all. Just wanted to say.
You know, people think that it's so hard to witness, but it really isn't. It's just something that, I don't know, it's not done anymore. Why? Now, there's some witness, I agree, that's a lot harder than that. I was doing a funeral yesterday. And the gentleman come up to me and he says, "I hate funerals." I said, "Why?" He says, "Because I hate God for causing them." I said, what do you mean by that? He says, "Well, God's punishing them, our family." And I said, "No, he's not." And we had a long talk. And when we got up, he had changed his mind. And so, that was a difficult conversation. I'm sure if, you know, I want to ask you, each and every one of you, what if they would have came up to you, what would you have said? Would you be a witness or would you go, "Oh, I'm sorry, I don't," and, you know, it's easy to kind of walk away. Maybe not because of your faith, but because those are hard questions, very hard questions. So, thank you both for sharing with us this morning. Our second scripture this morning is taken from the book of John, verses 1 through 9. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness concerning the light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light, the true light that gives light to everyone who is coming into the world." Amen.
Amen.
I want to warn you right now, and I hope you don't mind, but we're going to go over in this service this morning, and I was well aware of that fact, and I'm also well aware of the fact that probably many of you will complain at all. So God bless you all this morning. Have you ever read a scripture, like Wayne was talking about, so thoroughly that you believe there's nothing else to wring out of it? Well, that's what I thought about this scripture from John. I thought, I have heard that scripture so many times, it's just plain and simple. And that's what I thought. But the scripture, verse 8, just leapt out to me. "He himself was not the light," meaning John the Baptist. "He came as only a witness to the light." A witness to the light. Okay? That's a strange statement.
How many of us have walked outside on a summer day and said, I would like to bear witness that this is a bright and sunny? Anyone who's standing around you, my question is what you're putting in your cup. Light needs no witness. Light is self-evident. It bears witness to itself. And yet, there's the verse. Just bright as noontime, he came as a witness to the light. So it must mean that John is talking about another kind of light. And indeed he is. In that verse in John, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. But he was grieved because men loved the darkness more than they loved the light. And that's true today. Darkness gets far more press than light. To be blunt and honest with you, evil sells. But of course, without light, we would be in a mess, wouldn't we? We couldn't see. And if the sun were suddenly to burn out, we would have about 8 minutes of heat and light left, and then planet Earth would slip into a permanent deep freeze. In the Pacific Northwest, where it's overcast for most of the days of the year, people suffer from light deprivation, which results in mood swings and depression. There's even a scientific name for that problem: seasonal affective disorder. People suffering from SAD have to set up special lights, panels, and other things in their homes so they can have heavy doses of light in their lives in order to be happy campers. You know, without light, we can't survive. But we need another kind of light, too. Our souls, our very souls, depend on the light of God. In this spiritually darkened world, God uses us as witnesses to point out the light. The light has always been here. The light has never gone away. But that's where you and I come in. In one gospel, Jesus said he was the light. In another gospel, he told his followers, you are the light of the world. Jesus is the true light from heaven. But we too are called to be witness to that light, just as John was. And we talk about how people view us as Christians in the world. That's all well and good, and that's as it should be. But it needs to go past that. It needs to go that, hey, we need the light. We need the light of the world to stay in our lives, and we sometimes have to be that light. Our testimony for Jesus is crucial because it can mean life or death for a soul hanging in the balance of eternity, just as that man at the pit will be every day. But there's something else that sometimes gets in the way. You can't witness what you've not seen. Have you seen Jesus? I'll never forget some of the first times that my heart and eyes were open to his beauty. Oh, I had seen Jesus on the line. He was in the stained glass windows of my church. He was in the pictures that were hanging in the hallway of the entrance. Sound familiar? But they were just pictures. And they were just stained glass windows. They weren't the true light. And eventually, as my wife and I married, as we got busy with 3 kids, as we got busy with jobs that we worked constantly, we walked away from it.
hard witness. Who needs an irrelevant savior? I need a paycheck and a roof over my family's heads, not realizing where that came from. I will just take care of it myself. We've all done that before. I was in the dark. And I needed to find a reason to look at Jesus again. As we came back to the church, I went to the Bible and read about him. Read about his presence in my life. And I found a relevant Jesus. I found a man who made audacious claims of lordship and backed them up with miracles of love. A savior who was not interested in everything else in the world, but was also interested in me. That light came back. And begin to shine in our lives again. So I want to ask you today, have you let your light dim a little? Does it need to come back into your life? Do you need to pick up this book and reread what we've known from the beginning? Because it can happen to anyone. It happened to me. Happened to that man yesterday until the light came back in his life. So if you need to see the light, don't examine God through the stained glass windows. Don't examine him through the pictures in the hall. Examine him in your heart. Let his light and light give you life and light. A witness cannot be a witness without something to say. Amen.
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 Amen. So we're going to sing a song this morning that we haven't sang for a while. It's called "How Shall They Hear the Word of God." Do you stand and sing? The strength of the Holy Spirit today to stand up for you. to bear witness for you in a world that doesn't want to hear you anymore. There are still people out there who believe in you, Lord, and give us the strength to stand and save your word. Amen.
Amen.
Let's finish with I Need Thee Every Hour. She has agreed to allow me to play two of her songs next week. She can't be here because she's pitching, but she will be playing next week. Lacey Wheeler, pastor of the church in Market, Kansas. Okay. God bless y'all. We'll see you then.